what will be the relationship of these autonomous colleges to the universities after this?
See, if prior experience, I mean, in terms of the colleges that have already been granted autonomy, not in Delhi University, but other colleges like Loyola College Chennai, Ravenshaw College Cuttack, you know, they have a functional relationship with the university that they are a part of in terms of the degree that is being issued. But in every other matter, they have to do their own work, including the conduct of examinations and all of that. Now, you know, there is a contradiction. On the one hand, you have centralized syllabi. This government has gone one step further. It will also decide how to sort of, what kind of debates are to be held, what kind of films are to be screened, what kind of cultural or co-curricular activities are going to be held in colleges and all of that. It dictates. So there is a very large amount of centralization that happens and government interference and ideological interference. So it is a political interference of the government. But on the other hand, the government is also paying lip service to autonomy by telling us that we can frame our own kind of courses and all of that. In what kind of a context we'll have to look at it? You see, the government is actually interested in discontinuing funding and expansion of public funded institutions, higher educational institutions. So, you know, as a kind of a bargaining tactic, it's saying that, okay, ab tak jo bhi hum fund karte aaye hain, we will continue funding it. But if you want to expand, if you want to buy more books for the library, set up more laboratories, more classrooms, if your student intake is increasing, then you do it on your own steam.
Yeah, which so means this that, financial yeah. autonomy thing, if you could elaborate, like what exactly. is it's going to have an impact on the service condition of the employees and on the students also.
Yeah, I'll give you one example, and this is what we try to explain to our principal, in a, you know, who otherwise has not been representing the views of the teachers and the governing body. We have a budget, we have about 10 courses which we run, you know, some honours courses and the BSc program, BA program. And we have a budget of about 20 crores. And most of the money is going towards paying teachers their salaries. Okay, so you can say about 2 crores a course. Now, if you wish to introduce one new course, which they're talking about self-financing courses, new courses, we are told that, you know, we're not going to increase the fees much for the students, because naturally we don't want to become a commercialized institution.
Right.
That goes against the reason why this was set up by the founding fathers, by the Cambridge Mission. So what they tell us is, no, we won't do it. But we have explained to them that if you wish to generate 2 crores a year, and you have, you know, to live off the interest, you have to manage on the interest of a corpus.
Right.
Because you can't say we have it in 1 year and the next year we don't have it. Where will that extra money come from? You need at least a corpus of 50 crores if you wish to generate 2 crores to run it, you know, as an on interest basis. We just don't have that kind of money. And if somebody is promising them, maybe the private sector, some corporations which are interested in taking over, you know, the market is interested in taking over some of these institutions, particularly those which have brand value. So basically people are eyeing it as a kind of, you know, money generating phenomenon, which within a few years will degenerate so badly that nobody will want to even come here, you know, if the academic standards go down. So if you wish to have teachers of quality, you need that kind, you need to have decent service conditions, salaries and so on. Your fees will then have to be astronomical. So who are you going to be catering to? What has happened to some of these autonomous colleges which were earlier affiliated to, which were part of state universities, then now they're just affiliated in terms of getting degrees from there. They have a two-in-one system almost. They have some of the old public-funded courses for which they used to be famous at one time. And more than half of the college is all self-financing courses, where you have students who are very wealthy and paying very high fees, and teachers who are very poorly paid. Because the whole logic of the market is that you have to increase your profit. You have to charge a lot from the students by way of fees, and you have to pay very little to teachers by way of expenses. That is how you manage. So the whole system caters to a different set of people. What you teach, how you teach, and you know, what is the whole objective of that whole system is something that, you know, is not the raison d'etre of public funded institutions. So the whole quality of education will take a nosedive. Apart from the fact that access will be severely limited.
So what is...
Just to add to what Nandita said, I want to share an experience of NAC in Delhi University colleges, in the college where I teach, which is Khalsa College. when the accreditation team came visiting our college, and they interacted with us, and they suggested to us that part of the college premises should be used for running coaching courses for competitions, which is what, you know, these private coaching shops that prepare students for all
kinds
of...
So inside the college there should be a part
so,
of...
So yeah, for civil service or joint entrance examinations for engineering and medicine. So part of the college premises should be used for that kind of thing. Then the senior teachers, the senior faculty in every department would advise that, you know, they should have some kind of a corporate consultancy profile. Now what does that mean? That means that you liaison with corporate institutions and you understand their needs and then you try to tailor certain systems or actually work on projects that deliver to those needs. So, I mean, that is one way the government would say that it's increasing synergy between corporate India and academic institutions, but it is actually showing you that, you know, our traditional liberal arts and sciences are going to be undermined completely by market-friendly, commercial kind of endeavors, which is going to be the institution's focus once they get autonomy, because otherwise there's no other way apart from raising student fee. There's no other way of meeting the cost.
So that's where I wanted to get at. What will happen to the traditional pure science courses and the arts courses, and also what will happen to the students coming from the marginalized sections?
That's it.
Because that's, you know,
the marginalized section will get pushed out. You know, even today with very minimal fees compared to what it would become if you were, you know, autonomous or self-financing, a very large number of students are not able to pay the kind of fees, and many students say that we don't join since Stevens, even if we have got very good marks in school and we can make it, because we can't afford the fees. We have a large number of free ships, but even those account for a very small percent part of the fees. So it's already quite difficult for students who come from marginalized backgrounds to make it to these institutions, because even things like you charge for the, you know, some infrastructural things and so on is way too much for them to afford. Now if they have to pay for the teacher's salaries, which is the bulk of the grant that we get from the UGC, that grant would not come for the new courses. It means that it will be something like, you know, maybe Ashoka University and others which are self-financing. You every year you will pay 6 or 7 or 8 lakhs, I don't know, something like that. Who are the people who can afford that kind of money? So, you know, the whole thing is changing from the system of grants, and where you think of higher education as a public funded good. It's an investment. You put money into the citizen, you give the citizen that kind of education, that citizen gives back to the country. You want educated citizens. It's not as if the citizen has a private sort of need that you need education. The country needs its citizens to be educated. Second, you need a thinking population. So these social sciences and so many of these subjects, pure sciences, they, the main job is to make you think independently. Whereas if you're just going to have some, a few market oriented courses, that too for the quick returns, you know, the what the market needs today, you are training the population for low level skills, cheap labor, which you can put into you know, provide to the multinationals and big corporates, organizations. But the whole idea of the intellectual capital of the country is completely being sacrificed in this. That is a problem.